Por miles de años, los seres humanos hemos venido cruzando fronteras, escapando del peligro, buscando mejores condiciones climatológicas con la esperanza de una vida mejor. A menudo, las personas emigran en busca de trabajo y para obtener mejor educación.
The issue of immigration has always been an issue. Immigrants represent the influx of new possibilities. That's what the United States is about. They believe that by working hard and getting as much education as possible, that they will be able to be better off and make a better life for their children.
La gente arriesga su vida al cruzar la frontera de México ilegalmente. Luis, Sergio, Janet y Rubén Padre lo hicieron. Todos emigraron de Michoacán. Cada uno atraído por el sueño de tener más oportunidades. Un paso en esa dirección es la educación. Janet cruzó la frontera ilegalmente. Y no tuvo problemas al hacerlo. Pero ese no fue el caso de su marido, don Rubén.
Difícil fue a mi esposo cuando él vino, porque a él lo echaron en la cajuela del carro, se estaba ahogando, dice.
Éramos como 4 personas ahí, bien apretados, pero queríamos pasar. Entonces, la persona que venía manejando el carro lo iba siguiendo de migración. Y no se quería parar para que no lo agarraran, porque si lo agarraban iba a ser muy peligroso para él. Lo ponen en la cárcel o no sé qué les hacen. Y dejó el carro que se fuera solo y él brincó y se fue caminando, corriendo. Y entonces el carro se detuvo entró a una zanja, ahí se quedó. Y entonces hasta que llegó la migración nos abrieron la cajuela. Para podernos nos agarraron y volvieron a echar para atrás. Como a las 3 intentos que hicimos, pasamos como 3 o 4 veces. Yeah. En la última sí pude pasar.
Luis era un estudiante universitario en México. Hizo este peligroso viaje para ganar dinero y poder terminar sus estudios.
Almost more than 30 people walking through this hill, since we don't have any lamps, anything to look at. So the Coyote people must know the way to get to the destination. They say, just be careful where you are stepping on. Snakes, you can get into, spiders, anything. You're pretty much into the wild. So there was a downhill, and so we saw the helicopter close by. And they said, if you see a helicopter, just go to the bushes, get into it, no matter what. So we get into the bushes, and one of my friends got injured because got his feet twisted. And so I have to help him out we had a backpack. So I was carrying the 2 backpacks, and he kept on limping all the way. And I kept on walking with him. We made it. We made it through the whole odyssey.
Muchos inmigrantes encuentran trabajo en los Estados Unidos y luego intentan traer a sus familias a través de la frontera. El padre de Sergio García vino primero. Trabajó, se estableció, y mandó traer a la familia.
My father came down to Mexico. He said, oh, by the way, we're going back up north. And that was probably the first time I ever told my father no. Of course, he quickly asked, did you hear a question in my statement? My father supposedly paid for what you would consider the VIP service. And they were supposed to use their American connection, which is customs officials that they bribe. To simply, you know, wave us through. And they were basically held hostage in a rundown motel. And they kept us there for about 15 days. A couple of days after that, they had a little Chevy with a tunnel cover, and they wanted us to line up just like sardines. And they said, we're gonna get you across today. So I said, no, I'm not going. And it became pretty hostile, pretty aggressive. And ultimately he brandished a weapon and said, I'm not asking you if you're going or not, you're going. My mom became, completely terrified and said, you're making it worse, just go with him. And that was very, very hot during that time. But it's painful to relive it because we were stuck in there, no air or anything. A few other people in there passed out, and the rest of us, we were all praying because we just kept on going and going, and we never knew when they were gonna let us out of there, if they were gonna let us out of there. Eventually, they finally stopped and opened the tunnel cover. And it was, 180 degree contrast from being extremely hot to the beautiful, fresh breeze in Santa Monica. And at that point, my father was there, and he helped me out of the vehicle, and I was very upset with my father. So when he grabbed me to help me out, I pushed him away, and then I realized that I could not stand on my own. And so, of course, he held me, and he had to help me sit down because my legs were numb and were not responding.
Cruzar la frontera de México es poner en riesgo la vida, pues es una jornada impregnada de peligros. También es un ritual. Generaciones de mexicanos han apoyado económicamente a miembros de su familia para que hagan esa travesía. Para poder sobrevivir una vez que llegan aquí, los inmigrantes necesitan una fuente de ingreso. Encontrar trabajo mientras se ajustan a una cultura nueva es un gran reto. Algunos tipos de trabajo son muy peligrosos.
My job was helping this guy. So he was there with the butcher, making this half of the cows, one up, middle, and down. Up, middle, and down. And I would do that for 12, 13 hours. So like keep the pace. There were big accidents. I saw fingers, hands going out of the machine. That was there, I was watching that. And I saw that, you know. And I said, well, I guess I'm not gonna be here for long.
Muchos inmigrantes no solo tienen que lidiar con trabajos mal pagados y peligrosos, sino que también batallan para encontrar condiciones de vida dignas.
It was basically a wooden shack that my father and my brother at that time were living in, stuck smack between the railroad tracks and the highway. And every time the train would go by, that whole entire building would vibrate tremendously. And I kept on thinking to myself, what are we doing here? Our house in Mexico is not a palace, but it's much nicer than this, you know? So what was the point? What was the benefit? What was the logic behind bringing us here? You know, I was the president of my school in Mexico. I always say I was a big fish in a small pond in Mexico. And then I came to the United States and became not only a small fish in a bigger pond, but really an invisible fish.
Generally, it's a lot more difficult for people to obtain lawful status than is commonly believed. There is something called the 10-year bar, which causes many people to be ineligible for life from getting a green card. If they've lived here more than 1 year without legal status, they are then barred for 10 years. So most of the people you meet here in the United States, if they are undocumented, they have very slim chances of ever becoming lawful permanent residents.
Algunos abogados deshonestos se aprovechan de los inmigrantes indocumentados y de sus esperanzas de legalizar su estatus migratorio.
So I went to this lawyer and I told him, this is my this is my history, and how can we do something about it? And he said, well, yes, we can do something. And then he asked for cash. So I said, well, why don't you give me certainty about things? And he kept me like hoping for, you know, a couple months, but it was not as he was saying. And the more you start giving money to them, the more they're telling you one thing or another, and then money, money for this and that, and in the end, you don't get anything at all.
Luis quería trabajar. Sin embargo, para ser empleado legalmente en los Estados Unidos, se necesita un número de seguro social. Muchos trabajadores indocumentados usan números de seguro social falsos.
I was able to do a school to work program, and the manager right away said, would you like to work for us? And I said, I don't think I can work for you. And he said, why not? I told him, I'm sure I don't meet whatever the requirements are. And I said, I don't have any kind of ID. As long as you bring me your social security number and your school ID, we'll start paying you because you do really good work. I wanted to run home and tell my mom. You know, I got a job, but at the same time, I was very scared, you know? I didn't want to do anything that would come back and haunt me in the future. So it was really bittersweet news for me, and I had to sleep on it for a while, and, it, you know, ultimately I gave in, and, you know, unfortunately, that was a mistake as to my moral character, and that did become an issue later on in my life. Luckily, people were able to understand that this was half a life ago, and this was me being a young, scared person, and you know, doing what I did to survive.
Antes de que Sergio cruzara la frontera, el Acta de Reforma Migratoria de 1986 permitió legalizar el estatus de algunos inmigrantes indocumentados. Rubén Robles aprovechó esta legislación para hacerse ciudadano. La esposa de Rubén, Janet, ya tiene su tarjeta verde de residencia. Juntos, ellos manejan una tienda de abarrotes pequeña en el norte de California.
A nosotros ha sido bien difícil porque nos la hemos pasado trabajando. Los 7 días a la semana, pues son 13, 14 horas.
La educación siempre fue un sueño para ellos, pero nunca pudieron realizar ese sueño para sí mismos.
Porque yo también no fui a la escuela, nomás fui al número 6 en México, porque allá no nos ponen más, nomás ahí ya no estudiamos.
En los ranchos donde vivimos, México, que no es fácil allá, muchos niños no pueden ir a la escuela porque no tienen quizás para ir a pagar el camión que los lleve a la escuela o comida.
Por eso su papá quiere que él estudie. Los dos, yo y mi esposo.
She always told me, like, you know, like, I wish I had gone to more school because I really enjoyed school, but I just didn't have the opportunity. So I really want you to go get an education.
Y pues nosotros siempre hemos querido que él estudie para que pues él no trabaje como nosotros trabajamos.
Rubén Jr. obtuvo buenas calificaciones en su escuela primaria y secundaria. Para su preparatoria, tuvo la fortuna de ser aceptado en un programa único de preparación para el colegio, diseñado para dar acceso a educación superior a estudiantes de familias de bajos recursos.
We serve students from low-income families who will be the first in their families to go to college. And we are firm believers that for each student who becomes the first member of his or her family to go to college, an entire family's trajectory changes for the better.
Ruben's parents were completely supportive of his education, of his growth here, wanting the best for him. Our students go through a lot of struggles when they compare themselves to other students that might be in their neighborhood.
You know, I grew up in an environment where, you know, pretend to be a gangster, that was the idea of being cool. So when I got there, I was like, there's no way I can do this. But with the support of Eastside and the resources, I was so ready and prepared to go to college.
And so I remember actually very vividly in his senior year when he was taking our AP Physics class, and we actually at the end of the year have a unit on philosophy where things that don't have right or wrong answers, where there isn't necessarily a formula to plug into. And Ruben loved it.
A lot of people start out with this notion, all people should be treated equally. There are examples of this time and time again where you try to figure out, like, what really is fair? If you just entered the country from another nation and you don't speak English, should you just automatically be thrust into a regular class so that you are not treated differently? Or does your status merit some type of differentiation and treatment? It means you have to throw away your notion of equality and start figuring out where the differences are.
Cuando él se graduó de la high school, él fue a para allá, para donde es Nueva York, y me dijo, papá, dice, yo fui a mirar a muchas universidades buenas, y si me aceptan voy a ir a Vassar. Su mamá no quería que fuera lejos, pero lo aceptaron en la escuela Vassar, en la universidad, y se quiso ir lejos y lo apoyamos.
Siendo ciudadano, Ruben Jr. obtuvo beca para ir a la universidad. Aunque para estudiantes indocumentados en la mayoría de los estados asistir al colegio es legal, obtener préstamos es casi imposible. Trabajando tiempo completo, Luis pudo pagar sus estudios, obtener el certificado equivalente a preparatoria y después inscribirse en un colegio comunitario.
Start school. You know, ESL classes from the bottom. I moved to San Jose State, and I didn't want to ask for any money because I knew they would have to ask for my social security number.
Aunque Luis sigue siendo indocumentado y Rubén Jr., nacido en Estados Unidos, ciudadano, ambos tienen un reto en común. Para muchos estudiantes latinos, siendo los primeros de su familia en ir al colegio, llegar a las instalaciones educativas es ingresar en un mundo totalmente nuevo.
I grew up in a very Mexican community. When I first got to Vassar, I hadn't really interacted a lot with white people in the sense that, like, my school was all minorities. I thought the campus was really amazing. It was so big and so green, so full of trees, you know. But at the same time, it was so white. It was just like so white. Like, I had never been in such an environment that was just like so shocking.
My first time on Vassar's campus was very different from what I was used to. I remember myself in high school, my mother not being able to help me with my applications or my financial aid because she just wasn't familiar with the language.
I'm personally involved in wanting to make sure that first generation, specifically and especially Latino students, can come through this to this institution and that they understand that we do not view them as being less than, that we do not view them as having deficiencies here, that they're more than capable to do the work.
Students who have parents who've been to college have those parents as a resource to talk to about the places during that freshman year where the students feel confused or feel lost or want guidance. So our assumption was, if Vassar is beginning to make a commitment to bringing a more socioeconomically diverse student body to campus, and if that in part is going to mean that we're going to have more first-generation students, where are the gaps for this new student population?
I realized very quickly that there was definitely a class difference. I felt like the students here were better prepared than I was, better educated. That was jarring to me because I never thought it would be such a big deal until I'm confronted with it every day.
I got stopped by security multiple times because they didn't think I was a Vassar student. People see you as a threat, and I'm pretty sure that happened to a lot of my other Latino friends.
La discriminación racial es uno de los muchos retos que enfrenta la primera generación de estudiantes que asiste al colegio en todos los planteles del país.
So one of the things that the college is doing better is diversity training, its security officers. And I know now that they understand that what's been provided is no longer sufficient for our changing student body, and is providing more training along those lines. And what's needed and what's going to have to develop is this kind of a new way of communicating with one another.
Después de su tercer año de preparatoria, Rubén Jr. hizo su internado en una organización sin fines de lucro, donde abogados apoyan a mujeres y niños indocumentados que son víctimas de abuso.
Having interns who come from the community that we serve is particularly valuable because being able to connect with the client and be compassionate with the client when your own parent came across the border illegally, you understand what it's like to be terrified in a way that somebody who's born and raised here and documented could never understand.
Ruben cares about the work that we do. He spends time working with issues that involve immigrant communities, which is a very important population.
A lot of our clients really can't understand English. They can't write or read. And so for them, it's very difficult. Immigrant communities, especially Latino, they're very resistant towards seeking help.
Ruben brought not just his language abilities, he had a way to connect with my clients. They would call him back, not just because he spoke their language, but because he was sympathetic to their issues.
I remember there were so many times when I was younger that I felt completely powerless because I couldn't help my parents and they had like a lot of legal problems. And I guess that's one of the biggest motivations for me so I could help other people, especially coming from the background that I came from.
He is very clear. This is who I am. This is where I come from. This is my name. This is my background. This is my ethnicity. But I have the opportunity that everyone else has, and I'm going to use it because the people who believe in me, they want me to succeed. I've heard a lot of people say, and proudly, that I didn't want that life for me. And never once did Ruben say that to me, that I didn't want my father's life for me. What he said was, my father has that life because he wants me to succeed.
Los padres de Rubén Jr. cruzaron la frontera ilegalmente sin contar con mucha educación. El ver a su hijo graduarse del colegio llena una de sus más altas aspiraciones.
Bueno, cuando te fuiste, pues me sentí bien triste. Para mí fue difícil. Pero y ya cuando te graduaste, ahí fue la recompensa, mijo. Que lograste graduarte de la universidad que tú querías ir. Y eso fue lo más bonito de todo.
Después de 9 años en los Estados Unidos, Luis se graduó de la Universidad de San José. Después prosiguió a hacer su posgrado y obtuvo su maestría. Él continúa escribiendo poesía mientras espera por una legislación que termine con su estatus de indocumentado.
He's lived here for nearly 10 years and has been a law-abiding, contributing member of society. And the sad thing is that he will probably never be able to work legally in the United States and use that education.
Después de graduarse de la Universidad de Chico, Sergio García prosiguió a estudiar leyes.
All throughout my life, being poor and being chronically poor, I knew that the only way out, the only way to exit that poverty was to educate myself. Education has been paramount for me. Neither my mom or dad ever set foot on the school, and so they understand the importance of it. I started going to law school, graduated on May 9, 2009, took the bar right away, passed it on my first attempt, and I was very happy thinking that my life's dream of being an attorney was becoming a reality. And little did I know that was actually kind of just the beginning of the real challenge, the real struggle in life, which was the fight to be allowed to practice as an attorney being undocumented still.
Después de pasar la barra de abogados, Sergio luchó por 5 años para poder ejercer su profesión. Él demandó al Departamento de Justicia de los Estados Unidos. Esta demanda terminó con una decisión en la Corte Suprema de California.
Today, the state's highest court granted a license to practice law to a man who has been living in this country illegally.
El primero de febrero, del año 2014, Sergio García fue juramentado como abogado del estado de California.
California embraces me and allows me to practice as an attorney and to show that the American dream is still alive, to reward hard work, dedication, perseverance, and respect towards the system. My father had the foresight, the vision to say, in the long run, this is gonna be the place where you're gonna be able to have your American dream of making whatever it is that you want with yourself.